Lord, I pray for the families of those, Lord, who are dealing with grief at the Lord.
Thank you. So at this time, we're going to fellowship and welcome one another. So if you could just go out and hug your neighbors at this time.
Can you stand to your feet and give God a hand clap of praise for the ministry of Minister Calandria Reed? Come on, we can do better than that arena of praise. Come on, give her a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. I'm excited what God is getting ready to do. I feel like we need to get loose just a little bit more. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, God's getting ready to bless you today. God's getting ready to bless you today. Hallelujah. If you believe that God's getting ready to bless you, come on, put those hands together one more time and give God a shout of praise in this place. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I want to tell you, God, thank you, God, on the day. Thank you, God, for your grace and your mercy, God. We thank you, God, for your love and your kindness. Lord, we just thank you, God, right now, God, for meeting us here on today. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you send the word, God, that will transform our lives. God, somebody came looking, God, for the right word, God, in their season, God. Lord, thank God for a word, God, that will minister, God, to our spirits, Lord, that will uplift us, God, that will empower us, God, Lord, that will encourage us. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we ask you, God, to open up our ears, Lord, that we may be able to hear your word. God, open up our eyes, that we may be able to see in the spiritual realm. God, open up our minds, that we may be able to comprehend, God, what you're saying to us in this time, God. And we'll be so careful to give you the praise, the glory, and honor. In the majestic name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Somebody thank God. Amen and amen. God bless Sister Justice. I want to get on the organist and everything like that. So y'all know we get in when we fit in. Amen. Our musicians are out of town on spring break and everything like that. So, you know, but we still got to have church. Amen, somebody. So we're going to go to Genesis 32, 24 through 29. Genesis 32, 24 through 29. Genesis 32, 24 through 29. Hallelujah. Y'all expecting a word from the Lord on today? Hallelujah. Genesis, the 32nd chapter. If you're having a problem finding Genesis, I'm going to have to pray for you real good because it's the first book of the Bible, Genesis 32. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. So if you don't have smartphones, cellular devices, be reading from the New King James Version. For those who got the King James Version, it's almost the same thing. Genesis 32, 24 through 29 declares, verse 24, then Jacob was left alone. Somebody shout alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip. And the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaks. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Verse 27 declares, so he said to him, what is your name? He said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Verse 29 declares to him, Jacob asked, saying, tell me your name, I pray. And he said, what is it that you ask about my name? And he blessed him there. I want you to look at verse 25 one more time. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. Verse 29, one more time. Then Jacob asked, saying, tell me your name, I pray. And he said, why is it that you ask about my name? And he blessed him there. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, broken but blessed. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. That's what I want to talk about today. Broken, 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 but blessed. Many of us can testify today, saints of God, we've all been broken before. Some of us have even been shattered into pieces. You've been shattered before. You've been wounded. You've even struggled. And some of us, we were just like the clay that was on the potter's wheel that I preached about a few weeks ago. You were broken. You were shattered. And you had to be placed on the potter's wheel. And although the clay was messed up on the potter's wheel, the purpose of the potter's wheel was to take the clay, to mold it, to shape it, and put it back together again. And some of us, we can testify that some of us, we've been just like the alabaster box, according to Mark 14 and 3. The Bible tells us there was a woman who came with the alabaster box, and the alabaster box, it was expensive, and it had expensive perfume on the inside of it. The Bible tells us that she broke the jar, and she poured the perfume on Jesus' head. And although the box was broken, although it was shattered into pieces, the box had to fulfill a purpose. And his purpose was not only to anoint Jesus the Christ, but it was also to bless the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Well, Pastor, what are you trying to tell us on today? May I suggest to you, saints of God, that there is a divine purpose for your brokenness. It's not by accident that you've been broken in your life. Because we learned from Paul on last week that all things work together for the good. I want you to touch on them and say, neighbor, broken but blessed. Broken but blessed. And as we dribble through the text from today in Genesis 32, 24, I hope Randy and Ryan brought your basketballs to help me dribble, and Marquise helped me dribble through the text from today. If not, use your eyeballs to follow along. You'll catch it on the way home. Now, the Bible says in Genesis 32, 24, it says, then Jacob was left alone. He was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Number one, the first point that you need to take with you on the way home, sometimes God has to isolate you. Sometimes God has to isolate you. And sometimes he has to separate you. He has to pull you away from people. He has to pull you away from certain things. And oftentimes, God has to separate us in order to deliver a message to us. And sometimes we can miss God because we have too many distractions and we have too many outside influences that ultimately detour us away from hearing the voice of God. So the Bible says that Jacob, he was left alone. And what you have to understand about Jacob is that Jacob, he was rarely left alone. Well, Pastor, I need you to tell me. Well, the reason why he was rarely left alone was because he was always connected to his brother Esau, because he and Esau were born twins. They were born twins. And so Jacob, he was always connected. Somebody shout connected. He was always connected to his twin brother Esau, because the Bible tells us, according to Genesis, the 25th chapter, the Bible says that Rebecca, their mother, she was barren, and her husband Isaac, he went into her, and the Bible tells us that Rebecca, she conceived. And the Bible says in Genesis 25 and 22, says the children that were in her womb, she was beginning to struggle together within her, and she wondered why was the pain so severe. She was wondering why she was struggling so bad. So because of the pain, because of the pains that were going down on the inside, the Bible tells us that she went to go inquire of the Lord. So she went to go pray, Lord, why am I experiencing so much pain on the inside of me? So the Lord specifically told Rebecca, divisions on the inside in your womb. Two people shall be separated from your body. One people shall be stronger than the other, and the other shall serve the younger. And if you keep reading around verse 24, the Bible tells us when the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb. The first came out was red, and his whole body was like a hairy garment, so they named him Esau. And after this, the other brother came out with his hand, watch this, it was grasping Esau's heel, so they named him Jacob. So based on Genesis, the 25th chapter, we see that Esau and Jacob were always together, even in the womb, because they were twins. So Jacob, he was always connected. He was always connected, not only to his family, but he was also connected even on the inside of his mother's wombs. So they were family. They were always together, and they would cook stew together. And so God had to isolate Jacob and get Jacob all by himself to take Jacob, watch this, out of his comfort zone. Every now and then, saints of God, God will strip you of everything away just to get you all by yourself so that you can have an encounter with him. I just want to know, does anybody have their testimony? When you went through a season of isolation, Lord, why am I all by myself? Lord, it seems like I'm doing this all by myself. Lord, I need some support from my family and friends. But sometimes God has to isolate you and get you all by yourself so that you can have an encounter with him. So the Bible says, we're getting ready to get to the good stuff. It says that Jacob was left alone. And now we understand that he was left alone so he could have an encounter with God. He was left alone, and the man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now we have to be able to identify who is this man that Jacob is having an encounter with. Who is the man whom Jacob is having a wrestling match with? Now the Bible does not specifically state who the man was. However, some biblical scholars suggest that this man could have been an angel or a special messenger from God. And in order to support that this was an angel of the Lord, the Bible tells us in Hosea, the 12th chapter, verse 4, it says that, yes, he struggled with the angel and prevailed. He wept and sought favor from him. He found him in Bethel, and there he spoke to us. So based on this scriptural evidence, according to Hosea 12 and 4, we believe that this is the same angel of the Lord that was in our text today in Genesis, the 32nd chapter. So we are now left to believe that Jacob, he was wrestling with an angel of the Lord. And once again, the Bible says that he wrestled with the man with him until the breaking of day. So he was separated. He was left alone. So now we see the isolation. We see whom he was wrestling with, who was the angel of the Lord. And the Bible says that he wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. In other words, they wrestled all the way up until the morning time when the sun came up. Now, based on this evidence, saints of God, we can now draw the conclusion that they were wrestling all night long. Somebody shout, all night long. In other words, it was a fight at night. Now, we now see that not only was Jacob and the angel of the Lord wrestling, but they were wrestling at night in the midnight hour. I'm getting ready to go somewhere. Now that we have a better picture of the scenery of what was going on, once again, if you're ever out at night, in the nighttime, it's relatively difficult to see everything around you. It's relatively difficult to see your surroundings. And oftentimes, saints of God, when there's no light outside, it's hard to see in front of you. It's hard to see beside you. And it's hard to see behind you. And many of us are right there in our lives, saints of God. We're just like Jacob. You're in a situation right now where it seems like you've been isolated. It's been a little dark in your life. And because it's dark in your life, it's hard to see your way out. For some of you, there's been a struggle with your family, and it's hard to see your family being delivered. For some of you, there's been a struggle financially. It's hard to see your way out of debt. There's been a struggle in school, and it's hard to see the end of the journey. But I got good news for you on today. Somebody say, Pastor, what is the good news? The good news is that trouble don't last always. The songwriter put it like this. He said that late in the midnight hour, God is going to turn it around, and it's going to work in your favor. I come today to tell somebody, Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Verse 25 declares, now when he saw he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. The next point I need you to get, if you don't get another point, you need to get this. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, he bothered you so he could bless you. Oh, they didn't get it. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, he bothered you so that he could bless you. In other words, there was a purpose to your pain. Some of you got tied up. Some of you got wrapped up. Some of you got tangled up in some mess. And truth be told, it bothered you. It affected you physically. It affected you mentally, emotionally, and even spiritually. So the Bible says that a man wrestled with him. And whenever you wrestle and you get tied up, your objective is to tie somebody up so that they can reach their breaking point. Do I have any wrestling fans? I used to be one. And when you wrestle, you try to wrap up people to get a good grip on them so that you can control their mobility. When you wrestle and get tangled up, when you get tangled up, your leg is over their leg, your arm is in between their arms, and you just get all over the place and get tangled up. And the thing about being tangled up is that you try to get in a position, in the most advantageous position, in order to win the fight. Look, Pastor, what are you trying to say? That's what God had to do to you. He had to tie you up because he needed to see you at your breaking point. He had to wrap you up to get a good grip on you to control your mobility. And he had to tangle you up to position you for victory. See, some of you may think that the breaking was unnecessary. You may still have questions of why God had to pull on you, why God had to stretch you, why he had to stretch you thin. But I came today to tell somebody that he bothered you so that he could bless you. I just wonder, can anybody give God the glory for all the tough times, for all the times, for all the hang-ups, for all the wrap-ups, for all the tangles, because the Lord was breaking you, and it was necessary. Somebody say, he bothered you to bless you. He bothered you to bless you. So he bothered you so that he could ultimately bless you. The Bible says in verse 25, it says, he did not rebel against him. He touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. So Jacob and the angel of the Lord, they were wrestling. And the angel of the Lord, he had a few complications, and he could not prevail against Jacob. So the Bible says that he touched the socket of the hip. The angel of the Lord, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip. He touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip went out of joint. So what the angel of the Lord did, he dislocated his hip and gave him a limp. Somebody shout limp. Now, on last week, I told you that the friction was necessary. So the point of today is the limp was necessary. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the limp was necessary. So the angel of the Lord, he had to give Jacob a handicap. And whenever you have a handicap, sometimes you are dependent on things to hold you up. See, the limp, saint of God, it humbled you and it taught you to lean on God. Proverbs 3:5 says, there's no trust in the Lord, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. I just want to know, can anybody thank God for the limp? That the limp, it calls you to lean and depend on God. When you try to do things your way, God had to put a situation in your life to remind you that it was nobody but God who woke you up this morning. It was nobody but God who started you on your way. It was nobody but God who gave you the activity of your limbs. So God, he had to slow you down so that you don't forget who he was. Did you never say, neighbor, I thank God for my limp? Yes, sometimes it's hard for me to walk this day by day. It's hard for me to keep your favor. But Lord, I thank you for every limp that you placed in my life. So I thank you right now for the limp. So the limp was necessary. It was, somebody shout, it was necessary. It was necessary. So the Bible says in verse 27, it says, so he said to him, what is
your name. He said, Jacob. In verse 28, he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but your name shall be called Israel. For you have struggled with God and with me and have prevailed. Now, what you have to understand, saints of God, now throughout the whole Bible, out of the totality of the gospel, out of the whole counsel of God, in the Old Testament especially, your name meant something. Your name carried significance. Now, I'm going to give you six reasons, real quick, six reasons why names were important in the Bible. Now, number one, your name was important in the Bible because a biblical name could record some aspects of a person's birth. Number two, biblical names sometimes express parents' reaction to the birth of their child. Number three, names were sometimes used to secure the solidarity of family ties. They wanted to keep it in the family. Number four, names could be used to communicate God's message. Number five, names were also used to establish an affiliation with God. And most importantly, number six, what we're talking about today, biblical names are given to establish authority over another or to indicate, here it is, a new beginning or a new direction in the person's life. So based on what the angel of the Lord told him, he was told him, what's your name? He said, Jacob, and your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but shall be called Israel, which indicated that Jacob was supposed to go in a new direction in life. So Jacob, his name means deceiver or supplanter. So Jacob, he was a deceiver. Well, Pastor, why did they call him deceiver? Well, let me give you Bible. See, Jacob, he is a deceiver because Jacob illegitimately obtained his brother's Esau birthright by taking advantage of Esau's hunger, according to Genesis 25:29-34. Read it on the way home. So he illegitimately obtained his brother's birthright. So Jacob, he not only deceived his brother Esau, but he also deceived his father Isaac. And he deceived him in the fact that he deceived Isaac into giving him Esau's blessing as well. Now remember, Esau was the first to come out of the womb. So Esau, he was entitled to the blessings of his father. So Jacob, he is a deceiver because of what he did. But the angel of the Lord told him and said in verse 28, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Now I was looking at the text of God, Calamity, Justice, and everybody. I had a problem with the text. I struggled with the text. I said, Lord, something ain't right about this. Let's look at the text. Let's really dissect it. So, Lord, I have a problem. Something ain't right about this story about Jacob and Esau and the angel of the Lord. Lord, I need you to explain something for me. So now, the Bible says once again that it was the angel of the Lord and Jacob, they were wrestling. They were in the fight. There were a lot of undercuts and some punches going forth. There was a lot of rock bottom slams and stone cold stunners going on. Lord, they wrestling and getting tangled up and tied up and messed up and they went all night long. But Lord, I had a problem with the text. Lord, it didn't make sense to me. Lord, I see that they were wrestling. I see that they were fighting all night long at nighttime. But Lord, something didn't add up to me. Lord, I see that they were wrestling. And then all of a sudden, after the fight, it seemed like the angel of the Lord and Jacob all of a sudden became friends. Are y'all reading the Bible with me? I said, Lord, they just got done wrestling. And now they start having a dialogue with one another. Okay, we got done fighting. Hey, what is your name? What? Do you get to fight? Do you have a conversation with somebody after you get done wrestling all day? Lord, it just didn't make sense to me. So I was like, Lord, how could they be wrestling? And then all of a sudden, but they friends, now they talking to one another. Like, what's up, bro? You know, what's up, sis? You know, what's up? That didn't make any sense. So now we have to identify the intent of the angel of the Lord. Are y'all going to help me preach today? We have to be able to see why was the angel of the Lord wrestling with Jacob. So we have to look at the angel of the Lord's intent. Are y'all ready to have church with me? So you have to be able to understand that the intent of the angel of the Lord, it was not to hurt or harm Jacob. Jacob, but the angel of the Lord's intent was to get something to Jacob. I wish I had a church. Let me say that again. The intent of the angel of the Lord was not to harm or hurt Jacob. His intent was to get something to Jacob. Well, what did he try to get to him? May I suggest to you, saints of God, that the reason why God had to take you through was not to hurt or harm you, but his intent was to bless you. I need to tell you that and say, hey, bro, his intent was to bless me. I didn't understand the pain that I had to go through. I didn't understand the situation that I had to go through. But his intent was to ultimately bless me. So the Bible says that he said, I will not let you go until you bless me. So he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. And the angel of the Lord said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. Now you have to look in the Holy Ghost and put on your spiritual lenses to see what happened. He told him his name was Jacob, but the angel of the Lord told him, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but it shall be called Israel. When the Lord spoke his name, watch this, he released his name into the atmosphere. I'm getting ready to preach on today. Let me say that again. He said, your name shall be called Israel. When he said Israel, he released his name into the atmosphere. Well, Pastor, what are you trying to say? Well, after all the wrestling, Jacob was saying, Lord, I might as well get something out of this. I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. Well, I came today to tell somebody that God is getting ready to release your name into the atmosphere. I don't know what you believe in God this season in your life, but God is getting ready to release your name. In other words, somebody's got you on their mind right now, and they've been calling out your name. There are some people who are talking about you right now, and they are having good conversations about you. See, God, he had to place them on your mind. He had to place you on their mind. They are saying things like, how am I going to be a blessing to them? How am I going to sow in their life? How can I give into their bosom? Well, Pastor, what are you trying to say? Well, because your name has been released in the atmosphere, when employees start looking for the right person for the job, your name is going to appear in the atmosphere, and the employer, they're going to snatch your name because your name has been released in the atmosphere. I wish I had somebody to help me preach. When they're looking for someone to give the increase and the bonuses and the promotions to, your name is going to be somewhere in the atmosphere. And if you know that God is getting ready to release your name in the atmosphere, I need you to shout out your name right now and say, Lord, let it be me. We get justice, Emmanuel, justice, and Celeste. I need y'all to shout out your name and say, Lord, let it be me. So he releases your name in the atmosphere. Because Genesis 12 and 2 says, I will make you a great nation, I will bless you, and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. So you got to know, saints of God, that God, he's going to make your name great. You got to know, saints of God, that God, he is yet changing your name. Well, I know my birth name was Ricky. Well, Pastor, what are you trying to say? How is God going to change my name? Well, you may be labeled as sick, but your name is changing to healed. You may be broke, but your name is changing to more than enough. You may be tired, but your name is changing to strength. You may have trouble in your life, but your name is changing to peace. The Bible says, and he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with me. I need you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, everything I went through was worth it. Come on, look at somebody and say, neighbor, everything I went through was worth it. When I look back over my life, all the hurt that I had endured, every struggle, every insurmountable circumstance, every bad relationship, it was all worth it. I know you can't fully understand why, but everything you went through for God was just positioning you for victory. I know we haven't done it in a while yet, but I need you to get that arena praise towel in your hand. And I need you to wave that thing in the atmosphere and say, Lord, I thank you for victory. For everything that I had to go through, Lord, you will set me up for the victory. We've been talking about March in victory for all month long. I just wonder if there have any people who get ready to bust a move, who get ready to move in victory, who get ready to act in victory, who get ready to run in victory, who get ready to chase victory, and who's getting ready to have victory. If you know that you showed up, got the victory, the devil can go back to hell where he belongs. Wave that power one more time and thank God for the victory. The Bible says that they were wrestling in a place some of you, you were just like Jacob. You were in the tight hold. You were in the chokehold. And the Lord told me to tell you, for those of you who've been in a tight place, God said, get ready for a release. I need you to touch somebody and say, neighbor, get ready for a release. So you got the understanding that Jacob said, I won't let you go until you bless me. And in order for Jacob to receive his blessing, the angel of the Lord had to finally release him. I just want to know if anybody right now, you're in a tight place. It's been a struggle in your life. It's been rough and it's been tough. But the Lord told me to tell somebody, get ready for a release. I've been broken, but I'm still blessed. I've been crippled, but I'm still blessed. I just want to know if anybody testify in this place. You may have a limp in your body. You may have a limp in your finances. You may have a limp in your family. But the Bible says that I will bless the Lord at all times. And his praise shall continually be in my mouth. So Lord, I bless you with my lip while I'm going through my crippledness. Lord, I will bless you. And I just want to know that how bad do you want it? Is there anybody in here? Say, Lord, I need a blessing from you right now. And I won't let you go until you bless me. I came to prophesy over your life that for you who've been in a tight place, God is getting ready to release it to you. For those of you who need finances, the Lord told me to tell you, he's getting ready to release finances. For those of you who need healing in your body, the Lord is getting ready to release healing. If you know that God has been good to you, you've been broken, but you're still blessed. You've been broken, you've been hurt, but you're still blessed. You may have been broken, but you still got a praise in your mouth. You may have been broken, but you still can lift your hands. You may be broken, but you still got a praise. I need somebody to stand to your feet right now and forget about everything that you had to go through. Forget about all the tears you shed and say, neighbor, I've been broken, but I'm still blessed. Do I have any blessed people in this place? I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed going out. I'm blessed in the fever. I'm blessed in the city. High five your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm blessed. There's nothing you can do about it because God is getting ready to bless me for my testimony, for the struggle that I had to go through. I am blessed. Somebody put your hand together for the word on the day. Everybody stand to your feet. The message was broken, but blessed. Some of you all can look back over your life right now and see everything that you go through. And the Lord, his intent was not to harm you or hurt you, but his intent was trying to get something to you. He was trying to deliver a blessing, but he had to indirectly bless you to see you at your breaking point. So right where you are, I want you to close your eyes right where you are, and I want you to begin to look back over your life and see everything that you had to go through. Some of you are in a struggle right now. Some of you saying, Pastor, I'm in a tight place right now. Hallelujah, I'm in a tight place and I'm in need of a release. You need a release of his peace. You need a release of his glory. Hallelujah. Saying, Pastor, I just need prayer today. I need a little bit more strength. Hallelujah. Lift your hands right where you are. Don't worry about who's beside you. Hallelujah. Close your eyes. Focus on God, about your problem, about the struggle. Some of you have to wrestle in the midnight hour. Hallelujah. But God, he was preparing you to be blessed. Hallelujah. Same pastor, I'm here today, and there's a struggle in my life right now, and I need prayer. Same pastor, I want to connect with this ministry. I want to join on the watch care. But Lord, I need prayer on today. I need a touch from you, God. I've been broken. I've been shattered into pieces. Some of your marriages have been shattered. It's been broken. But God wants to bless you. Some of you, your career has been broken. It's been shattered. But you're still blessed because he still put breath in your body. He still gave you the activity of your legs. Is that one of these? I need prayer today. You want to make your way down to his altar. Said, I've been broken. I've been shattered into pieces. We have time for you, so hallelujah. Anybody need a breakthrough or blessing on this day?
For your power, it has resurrected me. Oh,
Do we have another?
Been broken. Been shattered. Hallelujah. Your hands are slipped at this altar. Hallelujah. Command you to lay hands on the shoulders. Hallelujah. Father God, in the name of Jesus. Miss Linda, I don't know what went wrong in your life. What took a turn? Hallelujah. But God's got you. He strengthens you in the midnight hour. Hallelujah. He lifts every burden that you have, everything that you've been through. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray, God, for this woman of God right now, Lord, that you got to take out the stripper. Uplift her, God. God, be with her in the midnight hour, God. Lord, everything, Lord, that she's encountered, God, Lord, she's went through. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you recompense her, repay her, God, for every struggle, God. God, we decree to her, God, a double favor, a double blessing, God, over her life, God. In the name of Jesus, God, we will take you, God, thank you, God, right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody put those hands together for Jesus in this place. Hallelujah. Tamika, everything is going to be all right. Hallelujah. I want everybody to point your finger, Sister Tamika. Say, Sister Tamika, everything is going to be all right. Come on, put your hands together one more time. Hallelujah. In this atmosphere, I want you to get your offering in your hands, get your tithe and offering for those who would like to bring your tithe into the Lord today. I'm going to ask our deacons to come. I need a pen to write mine down. Hallelujah. For those who know, once again, I gave my testimony on last week that Lord blessed me to purchase two more homes because I've been a faithful tithe and giver. I was the youngest person at the auction, and out of six homes, the Lord blessed me with two homes. So when I tell you, you better trust God in your giving, all right? God, I'm telling you, the favor of God is on this ministry, so you need to pay your tithe, bring your tithe to the Lord. Give it to the Lord on the day. Hallelujah. God is opening up windows. He's opening up doors. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. Don't have any cheerful folks on the day. We're glad to give unto the Lord. Hallelujah. He says that he that soweth sparingly will also reap sparingly. He that sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So if you're looking for to live in the abundance of life, if you're looking to live in overflow, you got to learn how to sow into good ground. Hallelujah. Get that seed in your hand. I'd like to get by debit credit card. You can see Miss Linda Barber. If you want to get by debit credit card, you like to give online, go to arenapraise.com and give online. Get that seed and raise it up and lift it to the Lord. Father God, I want to tell you, God, thank God today. Lord, thank God for God blessing us, God, in the service one more time. Lord, we thank God for the opportunity, God, to worship you and give it. Lord, we thank God for another opportunity, God, to show you how much, God, you mean to us. Lord, we thank God for the increase. Lord, we thank God for promotions. Lord, we thank God for the acceleration, God, on the job. God, we thank God for every open door, Lord, that's getting ready to, God, to hit our homes, God. Lord, we come against, God, poverty, God, even right now, God. For, God, we shall be a people, God, and live in the overflow. We shall be abundant, God. Lord, we shall, God, be prosperous, God. And, God, we thank God right now, God, for every seed that's been sown, God, or for every, God, person, God, who's been obedient, God, in their tithe and offering. And, Lord, we give you the praise, the glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may bring your seed unto the Lord from wherever you are. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray, God, over this offering, and we pray, Lord, that you bless it, God, in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless your deacons. We're getting ready to go. Thank you all so much for coming, Ms. Linda. God bless you, Tamika. Hopefully, our musicians will be back next Sunday. Be better and greater. God bless Mr. Justice for filling in. Father God, we thank God on the day. Thank God for your grace and your mercy. Lord, we pray, Lord, as we leave from this place, God, whenever you're present, Lord, let your blood, God, cover us, God, in our cars and our homes, God. Lord, we pray, God, the same arrival of God And God, we thank you, God, Lord. Bless us, God, on Wednesday. As we meet on Wednesday nights, Lord, bless us, God, on Sunday, God, until we meet again. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you, sons of God, marching victory. You got the victory.